So good afternoon, everyone. It's a pleasure to be here. This is, I think, the first time I'm sitting in these weird-looking mics and holding us back. And for a session which is actually starting 10 minutes before time, I don't think that's ever happened before. Rudely interrupted our coffee outside. But welcome. Hopefully you guys have had a nice lunch, woken up, given the previous discussions. So we get started. Interesting kind of panel here. We have the next 45 minutes to talk about the rural opportunity in India. It's a obviously large mass of people. Depending on actually whom you talk to and actually how you define rural, significantly large amounts of money is spent there. A lot of companies have built up a significant amount of businesses. 30, 40, 50% businesses for many, many leading companies come from what is the rural sector. But at every time you go and talk to somebody, there's like a few bright sparks and there's this, but if X was to happen, this would be a significant larger opportunity, right? And that's what this panel will do over the next 30, 45 minutes. There's a big clock in front of me. We'll discuss this, look at different points of view, and debate that, and we'll leave some time in the end for your questions. If you have any questions, please scribble them, and I'll promise I'll come back and ensure that one of the panelists is able to address that. So with that as a context, quick introductions. I think the MC introduced. My name's Abhishek. I'm a management consultant. Never had a real job. The only thing I produce is PowerPoint for my clients. I do work in the consumer and healthcare space for E.T. Kearney. And what I'll do is I'll maybe go around. We'll start with Dalveer, Shalabh, and Manav. Quick introductions about yourself, a little bit about your company, so that people know who you are. And then we'll come back and start the discussion. Dalveer.
Jai Ram Ji Ki. Jai Ram Ji Ki. So I'm Dalveer. I work for Group M. We have a practice for the emerging class consumer or the rural consumer. And I lead that practice across Asia Pacific. And we help our clients reach out to villages, to the emerging markets, to the next billion consumer. And that's what we do for our clients.
Hi, good afternoon. My name is Shalabh Saxena. I work for Canara HSBC Life Insurance. So the insurance space or the domain is what I represent. We are a joint venture of three banks, Canara Bank, Oriental Bank of Commerce, and HSBC. And life insurance is what we deal with. So there's a substantial opportunity as far as the country is concerned, of which obviously rural is one set and quite a significant one. So that's what we've been working with. We have a network of about 8,000 branches, the three banks put together, of which almost about 3,000 branches represent the so-called rural definition of, the so-called rural branches. So that's the, so there are a lot of challenges I'm sure we'll kind of discuss, but that's what I represent, that's where I work.
Hi, I'm Manav Danda. I'm the group CEO for a company called Subgroup Now, formerly Shedikari Brothers. We have three listed media companies. I'm personally a creative guy for first 10 years, and past 10 years I've been on the business side. I understand the full spectrum of media. In our group companies right now, we have a bunch of channels. We are fifth largest in terms of reach in the HSM market today as a network of channels, after the top four, Sony, Star, Colors, Viacom, and Z. All our channels, interestingly, are FTA channels. They're not pay channels. So all our channels have access to DD free dish. Most of the channels of, in fact, all the channels, almost all the channels of the top four are paid channels and do not have access to DD free dish, by virtue of which they cannot penetrate into the rural market, except giving barring one or two of the channels. And now we're expanding our broadcast networks over to about 10, 12 channels over the course of next 12 to 18 months, and they'll remain free-to-air channels, and we'll become the largest reach aggregator for the rural market of India. We also penetrate urban, however. Rural is an add-on.
Thanks, panelists, for the introduction. Manav, maybe we'll start with you. One of the things So there are always three things that people speak about, like when you look at any market, be it rural or urban. So, you know, so first is obviously money and affordability. The second is the need, you know, actually need for goods or services. And the third is awareness, right? Do I really know this is what's available? And I'm sure as a media channel, you play a critical role. And actually, the entire media industry has played a critical role in ensuring significant, you know, increase in awareness, in knowledge, information, aspirations growing. So based on your, you know, Shetkari Brothers subgroups experience, any stories, any anecdotes, anything that you've done as a group in the rural markets that you'd like to share, something that's really worked well and astounded you, wow, this is the presence, this is kind of the potential of that market. So,
well, a few observations. One is that from the broadcast side, now that we are being measured in the rural market by virtue of BARC, we often question that, is it being monetized like it should be? That's the very reason why we began measuring rural India. The first answer for that is, for 20 long years when TAM was there, we had no measurement for rural India, and what doesn't get measured can't get monetized. And what took 20 long years to measure can't get monetized in the next 10 months time. Not gonna happen, have some patience. Well, the numbers speak in the favor. The fact that about, 850 million people stay out there in rural India, contributes to half of India's GDP. So a journey has to be covered before we can monetize it in the right manner, and the impact can be felt as well. But a long way to go, to be honest, because as broadcasters, can you create a business model on the back of rural India only? Not as yet. Yeah. Not as yet. Other key aspect is that one biggest observation is that currently broadcasters are still treating rural India as a stepchild. They're not investing in content like one should right now to give their audience their due, which is more defined for their palate, their likes and dislikes. All the GCs by other broadcasters currently in which penetrate rural India actually play repeat content. And we as broadcasters, till we don't create premium content from their perspective, their paradigm, reach will always be a challenge to define the proper reach for that part of India. It'll always be between the journey between a Salman Khan Dabang versus a lunchbox for urban India. Right now, it's a very urban skewed here.
But do you actively, you know, as you're looking at, you said you're launching a GEC and I think, would you actively look at kind of content? First of all, I guess the first question is the need really different? Or is, for example, right, kind of if somebody just wants laughter and fun and action and all that stuff, that inherent need is exactly the same. It's how you serve to that need from a media perspective what really matters, right?
Yeah. I think that's a great question, because often it's perceived that the consumer from rural India is very different, will not like what's made for urban India. Yes, he'll not like something that's made for South Bombay and South Delhi, but that's not urban India. Right, the people who take train every day and go to work, well, they are a larger share of what urban Bombay is, as simple as that. And really, there is not much difference in what, at a macro level, right, on what they want to consume and what urban India consumes. I can give one small example from my personal experience right now. We run a music channel called Masti. It's in the music and youth genre. That's how the ad guy buys us. It's the most cluttered space right now, some 19, 20 channels. Channels like MTV, 9XM, Channel V are all in this space. We were always ruling with a massive margin from the number two channel. And when rural measurement came into being, a channel from down below called B4U got very, very close to us. Because we were very, very strong in rural, but very weak in urban. And for about 10, 12 weeks, we questioned ourselves, do we fight for being India's number one channel? Or do we say, fine, the rural audience is very different, and let's only focus on the urban market. But interestingly, it took us about 10, 12 weeks to analyze data and design a product accordingly. But by the end of it, we're leading in both markets. So we're number one in Delhi, but we're also number one in Bombay, and also number one in rural India. Yeah. And this is with content which is 100% duplicable. Music is the only genre which has 100% duplicable content. Despite with that, you can create a product which is equally well consumed, has high loyalty, both in the urban India sector as well as rural India sector. Yeah. So really, there's not much difference here.
Okay, excellent.
The reverse, however, might not be true.
So what's applicable for?
So what sober guys like is not going to be watched in rural India, but what masses like, masses like, yeah.
Okay, okay, interesting. Shalabh, we'll move to you. Selling insurance is a tough ask. Lots of effort goes in, kind of even on the urban side, making kind of tough inroads little by little, step by step. Rural, as you said, is a large opportunity, but investments, financial literacy, education, awareness, maybe the need is maximum there, but a big, big gap. Anything that Canara HSBC Life Insurance has been doing to kind of try to bridge that, any success stories in any region, and what's made that happen?
So, of the list of things that you said, I'll add one more, which is the product, and I'll qualify. A product, what works probably in a urban, and I would still not stick to a metro, etc., from a urban to a rural, the urban guy probably gets it, or maybe, somebody who's used to selling is able to explain to him the virtues and the values of the product. When you go to the hinterland, you have to kind of customize your products accordingly. What sells or what probably would sell in a urban kind of a setup might not really work. And I'll just explain. I'll give you an example. I think about last year, there were these two products which were launched by the Prime Minister called PMJJBY Prime Pradhan Mantri Jeevan Bima Yojana, which was a 330 rupees, 2 lakh cover policy. And there was a 12 rupees accident policy. I'm sure, we used the brand ambassador for that. It sold about 12 crores, that's the opportunity available. It sold across, not just rural, So what comes out very clearly is that unless you make this product easy for the other person to understand, do not design products, and it's easier said than done, do not design products which are difficult to explain. Because what happens is that even, and we've done a lot of CSAT surveys, etc., even if a customer buys, say today I buy a standard ULIP or a traditional or one of these plans which are there, after 1 year, if you were to ask me what product have I bought, I'll probably struggle.
I was going to nod my head and say.
So that's exactly the problem, and that's not a good sign as far as an enterprise is concerned. You are in a business where a customer has bought something from you and he does not know what he's bought. Our recall, when we call up our customers and ask them what have you bought, they'll remember the amount that they have to pay. 25,000 I have to give every year on so and so date, so and so month. Uske aage na usko pata hai, he has no idea. One of the things, and just to kind of move this. One of the things that we've done specifically in the rural sector, because what happens is in the urban sector, it's much easier to pick up the phone, ask what have I bought, and it's easier for you to explain, and it kind of, he kind of gets it. In a rural kind of a setup, or where you kind of, where the customer has bought, say, a 300 rupee product, we have a 100 rupee product also. You have to kind of touch base with him once in 6 months, once in 9 months. You have to reiterate what he's bought. And that's extremely important for the confidence of the consumer. Unless he is reassured that the decision that you took, you want, and I don't know whether I should be using this word, he should not feel conned. He should not feel that, yaar, aapne pata nahi kya deke gayo. I have no idea what I bought. So you keep on saying that this was good for you, this you still need it, and it's good for you tomorrow, God forbid, if you were not around. This is how it's going to kind of, make up for your financial loss, so on and so forth. So those are the things that we do. That's number one. Number two, remain completely and constantly in touch with the consumer. Be more so in these kind of areas rather than, your urban areas. Go and meet him, organize meetings, and somewhere we've tried to link our other programs, to these centers so that, we constantly keep on meeting these customers at least once or twice a year. Because we are, insurance is a long-term contract, minimum 10 years. You have a five-year contract also, but basically insurance would be 10 to 20 years. So you have to keep on repeating the same thing, explaining to him the value, so on and so forth, so that he knows that, these guys were not there at the sale time only. They've been around for some time. So those are the things that we've kind of done.
Okay, excellent. So, constant touch, as you said, and constant reinforcement, like they've not made the wrong decision.
Yeah.
So Dalveer, we'll shift to you. Obviously, a lot of clients come to you and ask you kind of, hey, help me solve this problem, which what Manav and Shalabh spoke about. Anything that you can share based on your experience and your work where some success and some green shoots?
I think the first big challenge that most marketers have is how do I define rural? And as we saw on the panel itself, rural has got different meaning. So, and I'll explain it to you. So when you look at the census definition, it says any place which is less than 5,000 in population, 75% of the income coming from agriculture, not falling under any municipal corporation or cantonment. That's how the census of India defines rural. Most FMCG companies follow that definition. So when they say rural, they are saying, yes, I want to reach out to villages in 5,000 and below population. When you talk to a white goods client, rural for them becomes 1 lakh to 50,000. So suddenly the definition changes. Okay. When you talk to people who are working in social areas in metros, say in Bombay, your maid, your driver, your lift guy, your rickshawala, now he's not in a rural geography, he's staying where you are staying, but the mindset is rural. So I think for marketers looking at their product, their category, defining this, saying what does rural mean to you? And when we took this Indian rural model to Southeast Asia, to Sub-Sahara, Africa, and to Latin America, they said we don't have media dark markets. So for them, the definition of rural was CDE consumer. Now, when you look at a global definition, is anybody who earns less than $3. So on a purchasing power, again, you can define rural. So if you're looking at rural, first task is how do I define rural as per my product or my category? Yeah. So that's a big learning when it comes to defining these markets.
Okay. And somewhere where you've kind of used this definition and then helped somebody succeed? Or?
So we use it with all our clients, whether it be Unilever, Colgate, any one of these clients. We help them define in what geography, and even when we take these models across different countries, we help them with saying, okay, this is, so that gives you the size of the market. Then you know what's the source of the business. Because normally people say 900 million people living there, huge opportunity. Now, within this 900 million, how many can really afford your category? So that's how we help our clients to define on the sizing of the market. The other three M's, which I'll come to, is then what message? Now, when we say to an urban consumer, Lifebuoy hai jahan tandrusti hai wahan, all of us can understand. But for a rural consumer, soap and health, he doesn't see a connect. So you have to explain to him, well, how does soap and health connect? So that's the second part of it. How do you define messages? And I disagree with Manav on saying you can have the same stuff which will be liked by both urban as well as the rural consumer. No. It has to be language, area, and culture specific. Yes, you can be in a category, hasse. Hasse wang is a part of our Indian culture. It will remain a part of our Indian culture. But that doesn't mean that it is said in the same language. No. Hasse Vang in Bhojpuri will be very different than the lingo that you and me speak. So that's the second part of it. How do you take the message? How do you convert the same urban message of, in the case of Lifebuoy, it was health. How do you explain that health to those consumers? And if I need to build on that, health for a child in rural is, if I fall sick, I'll not be able to play with my friends, I'll not have fun. That's the meaning of health for him. Health for a chief wage earner in the same rural markets is, if I fall sick, I will not earn my 2 days of my wages. So I lose 400 rupees. The same health for a housewife in rural would be, if I fall sick, who will take care of my family? Now when Lifebuoy is talking to you and me, they don't decode this for us. Whereas when you go to these masses, you need to decode the same message of health in their language, their culture, their environment.
Okay, so, and just, that'll be, actually, that's a really great example. I'm going to kind of react to that and ask you. But wouldn't the same definition apply, for example, as you said, you know, my driver, my maid, my lift kind of guy, right? If they are sick for 2 days, they would think about, you know, daily wage earning. Even in a city like Bombay, they would actually think about exactly a similar, you know, kind of thing, which is more of a income-related parity of behavior, that if I'm sick, I can't get earning for 2 days or things like that.
Yeah. So that's what
also,
I said.
And sorry. So diverse language can very well be in Bombay, Delhi, Calcutta. There are enough people who are from Bhojpur out here, enough people who don't speak Marathi, live in Maharashtra. So that's relevance cut, but not geography cut by rural or otherwise, right? So do I speak a certain language? It's not relevant to me. But if I live in rural, it comes with the environment I live in and the limitations or the opportunities of the environment per se. Language will vary. We have 845 languages or more in the country. That will vary diversely across. Yet you can have common cuts across, like in Tamil Nadu, one language, like in HSM, one language, and there's relevance all throughout. Hindi can never be irrelevant in HSM, rural or otherwise.
No, I'm talking about the mindset.
Yeah,
so,
okay,
so,
exactly.
So we said your maid or your driver, it's the mindset. The geography is urban, the language could be Hindi,
but the mindset. Yeah, exactly.
Mindset is the
problem. The same driver, what he's saying, the same driver in Bombay will for a while to have similar mindset of the village still.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
It won't change because it's come out here.
No, that's what I'm saying.
Yeah. No, that's exactly
the point. You're actually building on that. That's what I'm saying.
Yeah. Exactly. So I think Dalveer's kind of thing, right? I think interesting point, and I'm sure when, you know, they thought of this panel, I'm not sure who thought about this, right? But if you think about it, we are used to a very traditional definition, right? I'm sure if I had asked you before this session to define rural, there would have been 80 different definitions, right? Or the traditional definition would be a poor kisan with a big hull and like kind of, you know, kind of thing. I think what this thing is learning is, first of all, that definition itself varies. It varies to the context. It varies to the situation you're in. It varies to your product, your service. So it's kind of, I think what we're decoding it is to the mindset of that consumer, how he or she is interacting with a product or a service. And that may cut across, right? Geography, brand. Well, sorry, Manav.
An important point to note is you defined it as villages below 5,000 population, and the income is 70% or more from
agriculture. Yeah, that's the official quote-unquote, right, kind of.
But that definition still contributes to 50% of India's GDP. So it's a very important opportunity by itself.
Yeah, no, it is, it is.
It's specific to a category.
Yeah. Absolutely.
It's very specific to a category.
Yeah, and again, I think, you know, as all of us travel, that exact like kind of thing, driving through, I'm from Chandigarh, driving through some of the quote-unquote rural areas of Punjab, you know, the consumption of the categories, or if you go to Kerala, like high degree of urbanization, it's actually tough to figure out where a village is and where is it not, right?
Yeah.
And is it truly agricultural income? You know, very little of it is left agricultural, right? So it's
to add to what you were saying about Punjab, I was there 3 days back in Jalandhar. So we are doing a mass campaign to reach out to masses to tell them about what are the government schemes. Now the program is working in two states, UP and Punjab. UP, we're getting 1,500 people, great response, everyone is around there. The same program, when you do it for the rural Punjab, sab pakke ghar hain, pakki sadke hain, nobody comes out. You know, you still have a BPL consumer. Till I park myself in that BPL area, I'm not getting the same response. So yes, the stimulus is same, the process is same, but markets are different. So you need to change. A great learning for us. We took the same module saying, okay, it's working. It should work in both the states. It's not.
Yeah. No, and that's, I guess, what makes India what it is, right, kind of thing. So, Shalabh, we'll go to you. So, you know, and so, sorry, I'll give you an opportunity to react also. Maybe go ahead first.
Yeah, so just, you know, on the discussion, it's this entire market is a factor of the exposure that the people get, you know, in the living in the particular areas. Something which is very normal and natural for us and to our drivers and maids, the example that has been quoted, might not work for, you know, people living in these areas which are far, you know, far away from the city. So you to actually get down to their level, and it has nothing to do with the income status of the, because you will still have very rich farmers there, but he's not exposed to what's going around in the world. So you have to really, and you could customize your products or whatever you want to kind of communicate to him, and that's where your first point where you said awareness is a critical factor towards developing this market. And that's the first step, if I may say so. You know, so if you are able to get him on board in terms of the value that your product is giving or proposes to give, then pretty much, you know, that your work is done. And then you have to kind of get him on your sales cycle, so on and so forth. But exposure is what all the companies have to get together and kind of give to those audiences and realize, or at least, you know, kind of impart the value that you are able to, you know, sort of give to, that you want to propagate. And once you do that, that's a market which is open to you. Easier said than done. There's a lot that needs to be done. And that's a cutting across all industries.
Okay. So Shalabh, I'm going to actually ask you a follow-up question. So I think all of us understand, as you said, like significant effort up front to create that awareness, to create that education. In the end, however, the customer that you get, the consumer you get, is he or she more loyal? Is the effort worth it? Or kind of, you know, you come back and say, hey, insurance wait, let's go to South Bombay and find 25 people, right? Is it kind of... Because, you know, I'm sure you have limited resources, limited bandwidth, money, time, effort.
Yeah, so one of the things that we've realized is that you cannot pursue this market as a hobby. You know, you can't really say that, you know, okay, fine, you know, I'm here too, I'll also do here. You have to really work in a very, very consistent manner over a period of time. Results wouldn't be there immediately, and you will, and what you said is absolutely right. You know, your entire wealth is unfortunately or fortunately concentrated in those top 20, 30, 40 cities. You know, pick up any financial services product, pick up mutual fund, pick up insurance, you know, you'll have that. But slowly the world is changing and India is changing. So somewhere, and that's where this entire, if you see the macroeconomic environment, you know, you have what you think. Apparently, the traditional definition of a rural might not be there because they are also kind of coming up the curve. It's just that the industries have to kind of lap onto that and then take it as a hook and then develop that market. For all of that, you need a lot of patience and obviously deep pockets. So somewhere you have to balance it to answer your question. You can't pursue either or. You have to balance it, and over a period of, and we are seeing results, not that they are fantabulous or whatever, but you know, from something which was practically a single digit, you know, it's gone to a level of 18%, 19%, 20%. At any given point in time, will it become a 60%? Probably not. But at least that something, an opportunity which never existed, if it is today at 18, you know, even if you are able to take it to a 25, 30, I think it's a good sort of, you know, you are actually reaching out to the people. That's one. Two is, and that's the important part when I mentioned about the product, and product also comes with pricing. So what a cycle which probably works in a non-rural kind of environment where there are steady incomes, so on and so forth, that doesn't work in rural, you know. So there you have to adjust to that, to their economic cycle, you know, where probably they are used to paying only once a year. I'm just giving an example, you know, probably at the time of harvesting or whatever. You know, so you have to kind of customize your solution so as to suit him. So you have to get down to his level and understand and then kind of propose a solution made for a different market. Can't really, you know, it's not worth it.
Okay. Manav, to you, you know, if this market has, you know, you gave the example of Masti, but I think if this has to be a larger contributor for you, what's one thing that's holding back if you had a wish to connect?
I think time, yeah, as simple as that. Like you said, it will take a while till, and I can speak only broadcast perspective, to be honest. I won't have perspective of FMCG or other policies or, you know, other verticals. But and we also understand that we ride off opportunities for other businesses. So as insurances or FMCG or auto sees opportunity in rural, only then will we have an opportunity of monetizing rural. So finally, we are feeding off your opportunity, right? And the sense that we are getting is just this, that it's probably in the early mid-teens of what they want to allocate as a marketing dollar share to rural market. It might touch 30, but it won't happen by default. It won't happen by choice. It'll have to be a focused effort in somebody believing in the opportunity first, right? And from a content creator perspective, investing in content on the back of which, if brands will ride for mass reach, and if that converts, great for all of us. But from our perspective, if you have to build mass reach, you have to have great content, and only then will ad guys invest in the dollars to convert opportunities here.
Okay. Yeah. There'll be a quick comment from you. How do you, what's holding it back for it to be a bigger, larger, more significant?
I think most of the CEOs today are doing a lip service to rural. And most marketers are doing lazy marketing when it comes to rural. Rural is long term, rural is long haul. You need to be committed. There's nothing called half pregnant. If you're into rural, you're there into it for next 9 months, 12 months, next 5 years. I think that commitment is something which is missing. So, and I've seen it not from today. I've been doing this for living for last 20 years. Apart from the market leaders, the Unilevers, the Colgates, the other marketers are still doing lip service. So I think that's the market for future. And if all of us believe, then we should put larger commitments and do more experiments. Everybody wants to learn from somebody else, but here, you have to do your own pilots, learn from your own mistakes, and scale it fast. So that's what I would say.
I would endorse that. I think, I'm sure a lot of us know about KKT, Kan Kajara Tashan, an actual initiative to penetrate to media dark India. As I last checked yesterday, was at 45 million subscribers to date, and over 1.1 billion ad impressions in little over 2 years' time. And it's only off HUL's rural marketing budgets that was a small portion of it. And I think it's a great opportunity, and what we would want to share right now is that we are ourselves launching a similar platform, and a caller back, KKD works on a missed call platform where a platform calls you back, and we ourselves plan to launch it by May, June this year, our own platform of similar nature. So the GC that we're launching is called Happy. It'll have a digital opportunity called Happify. Very importantly, it's not targeting the existing audience of the TVF and AIBs. It's going after the last 500 million people who have come online or will come online, because real India rests over there. And we're also following that up with something called Happy Me, which we are calling Happy Mobile Entertainment, right? Which will be exactly that, a mobile missed call-based platform where you probably don't have power all the time or you're out in the fields.
There's one kind of cell phone seller, right, who sells mobile phones, just like one of the millions of people who sell cell phones. You can see a sign, he sells everything, every brand that you may have never even heard about, you know, it's available. We met him actually 3 months ago. He makes about 60-70% of his revenues doesn't come from, you know, a typical mobile seller will sell mobiles, he'll sell data cards and all that stuff. This guy is unique. He is kind of obscenely rich, right? In 3 years, he makes 60-70% of his money by selling power banks, right?
Battery packs.
So that's what he sells. He's in a small town. He is one of the top 5 or 7 importers of battery packs from China. He himself travels to China, buys battery packs, puts pictures of gods on them, and then sells them, right? 1,800 rupees, 1,500 rupees. Huge market. Very proud of what he identified. He said, you know, poor power availability, a lot of people traveling. There's a big carpet area. You know, a lot of people go out the entire day. There's not enough power and all that stuff. Has built up a crores business just on very, very power banks. And, you know, he's kind of in the telecom circle, very small, right? I'm not saying he's kind of will ever make it to national news, but in that area, very, very successful. And this is when Reliance Jio was launched. You know, overnight, they paid a lot of people to put up hoardings and all that stuff, right? He got like the maximum number of hoardings put in that town. Overnight, you know, he had all of his clients, customers, you know, they had this very attractive scheme. They give you a phone for every hoarding you put and all that stuff. You know, so very, very kind of thing, right? Very local opportunity, very, very clear identification of need, has a product, you know, gets the product, makes it available. It's very, very relevant. And if you go out there, people say, Bhagwan wala power bank, right? It's not branded, but everybody knows that he creates it. I'm sure now that by this time, the next 10 people must be doing exactly the same thing, and he'll move on to something else, right? But it's, and I think that's the only thing I would say is, in addition to what others have said, it's slow, it will take time, it's education, it's commitment. But I feel as marketers, what we miss out is observing those, right? And it's not only a rural thing like that. Maybe, you know, in Bombay trains, we have so many entrepreneurs making money, right? How do they make money? They observe. They observe what people want. You'll come up with a keychain. You'll come up with something else that works in a Bombay train, right? And it's a big ecosystem. You can have turnover of many, many lakhs and few crores by that. I think that's the opportunity. And unfortunately, and the good thing is this opportunity can be replicated, right? Power banks is not a UP only or a Mirzapur only phenomena. That's a phenomena out of 800 people, it's a phenomena for 700 people. And maybe there's more, right? There'll be movie loads, there'll be media, there'll be insurance product. I think if we can think about those and adapt that, create that is kind of a thing. The second thing I think I would point out, again, from a personal client experience, is just sheer availability. And it is just amazing, and I'll agree with Dalveer when he said, I think people have done it in a kind of, you know, half-hearted way, right? This full hog. One of our clients, a large edible oils, right? Edible oils in nice bottles and packs. Traditionally, people think villagers or rural area will not consume that because they're not interested in health. They don't, you know, it's costly and all that stuff. What we've proven is sheer available, making the product available. And actually, it's expensive to carry the product all the way there. Just making it available at the same price what's available in the nearest large town gets you kind of double the sale. So people want it, they have the money. Nobody's putting effort to put it on a truck, get it all the way there, And, you know, it's not like the old stock. They don't want, you know, the dirty stuff, right? Exactly what's available in a town 8 kilometers away or 12 kilometers away want exactly the same product, but in their own village shop and kind of thing, right? And that's it. And I think as roads get better, as, you know, infrastructure gets better, as more and more people commute, transport gets better, logistics get better, more villages get connected. And that's what you've seen in a Punjab and a Kerala and other parts, or a Gujarat rural, right? That's significantly driven consumption up. So at one end, you have availability. On the other end, you have awareness through media and other platforms. And that's kind of unlocks the market in that. So with that, I can see the clock going down. Maybe any final points, Manav, anything from you? With Alveer, a reaction then, and we'll open it up for a few questions before that clock winds down.
I think we've heard of many government schemes. What we've seen in the last 12 to 18 months, there are four government schemes which are really showing results. So we talk of, you know, many government schemes, and you hear of many government schemes, four schemes which are really showing results, and you can see their impact. Top of them is Manrega. 36,000 crores going into the hands of consumer. Chalo chori hota hai, nahi pahunchta hai, aadha chori ho jayega. Now, the impact of that is migration of labor from Bihar, UP has come down. And the cost of labor has gone up in Punjab, in Haryana, in Kerala. So people have now opportunities to work in their own state. So Manrega is big one, yeah. The second one is NRHM. Again, health mission, yeah. Again, crores of money going there. Now you have a grassroots health system through Asha Didi, auxiliary nurses available there. That's another thing which you can see, and you can see it in the smallest of the villages. The third is your Pradhan Mantri Sadak Yojana, which is connecting villages. So those of us who travel into rural markets, if it took me 5 hours from Patna to reach Sonpur or Muzaffarpur, now the amount of time that we take to travel to these markets, so access to markets is much better. Government wali bus aati thi subah sham. Now you got multiple local modes of transport. That's another scheme which you can see when you travel across villages, which is showing results. The fourth one is your Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, which is to provide basic homes and subsidy to the BPL consumer. I think these four schemes, and the fifth one, which is the way to Lakshmi, is Saraswati. The BPL consumer across, whether it is your mid, our left guy, or the rural guy, has understood that investing into education is the way to Saraswati. So I see a huge change. Rural, which was there 3 years back, 4 years back, is very different. It's full of opportunities today, and it's a prosperous rural that we have today. Yeah.
Okay.
I'll just carry on to the list that Dalduvi just mentioned. You know, the ecosystem, and we've seen various initiatives. The last mile connectivity now is being built, be it in the initiatives that he's mentioned, the focus on digital, because typically in a financial services, that's the industry that I represent, you know, you might communicate whatever, but the last mile in terms of collecting the payment, remitting payment, etc., there has to be a physical interface, which kind of restricts the entire, you know, the scope that you can do with, you know, with the population that you have. So once this ecosystem is ready, which is what, you know, are the various steps that are being taken in terms of the digital payments, so on and so forth, if you are able to kind of connect that with awareness and the constant engagement with the consumer, I would really say with confidence that, and stick my neck out and say that there's a huge opportunity waiting. The problem, you kind of tend to limit the problems that you have currently, you know, in terms of it's a vast country, you know, there's a cost benefit that you have to see. All of that kind of gets, you kind of address that by getting into all of this digital side, so that it again might take another 2 to 5 years, but nobody knows. You know, nobody thought that we'll have a 1 billion internet connections. Nobody, if you read the reports, etc., you'll have about 700, at least 70% of the country moving on to the smartphones, etc. You know, so those last mile connectivities and the entire macro environment is being kind of built up now, you know, for India to really prosper. And I think once we are able to get that, you know, we will be able to push a lot of products and this thing into the consumers.
Thanks to all the panelists. Thanks for an interesting discussion. Hopefully all of you took away something useful. It's been a pleasure to be here. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot.